So welcome to the March meeting of the CentOS Board of Directors. Because people are traveling, I did not expect this to be a long meeting. I'm happy to see that we do have quorum. We don't have a link to the previous minutes, but first thing I wanted to do on the agenda is welcome Troy. The emails have gone out to all the candidates. We had some really, really good candidates this time around, very pleased. And Troy was elected. Sean is planning on sending an announcement out and later a blog post when he gets back from scale. So just wanted to formally welcome Troy to the board of directors.
Welcome, Troy.
Thank you. Good to be here.
And I'm just going to.
Good luck.
I will need that.
Neil's trying to kill me. I'm not sure I like the system we used. It may have been configuration. I kind of like to be surprised at the end, and it kind of showed you how it was going during the voting. So it was interesting to watch how the voting went. And of course, it was all anonymous, so we didn't know who had voted yet until you only knew that you had voted. So it was an interesting system to use. All right, going down to the issues, I owe everybody number 125, which is board activity, clarity, and governance. I think the best way to handle this in GitHub is I will probably make a pull request depending on where this actually lies in GitHub, and then ask all the board members to vote on it. If we only could use ranked choice for governmental elections. It definitely like bounced around, I will say that. I'm used to Garrett where like the TC can do a roll call vote. GitHub does not have that functionality. So I do want to make sure that once I get it rewritten based on the feedback we already have in 125, that everyone has a say to agree to the wording in it. And I think the best way to do that is to have all board members 2+1. Troy, we will have to make sure you have access. Another thing I did want to do, and I'll go back up a minute. I wanted to publicly thank Fabian for rebuilding systems on his PTO. So everyone give him a big thumbs up next time you see him. Buy him a coffee.
Yeah, I did already. So but yes, please do.
So yeah, I mean, that was awesome that he did that for us. It also is kind of bad that he had to do that for us on his PTO. So just something to keep in mind next time you see him is to buy him a coffee, a waffle, or wherever you are, what is appropriate. 126 is charter, the SIG Council, Brian, that is you. Are you ready to talk about that at all, or are you still working on that offline?
No, so the I think where we left off was we were going to vote on language to add this to the website and have the board members individually vote on that pull request. That's not done yet, but I should have it in the next few days.
Okay, so it sounds like you're kind of in the same position I am with mine. And we'll use the same voting as we just discussed for number 125 on 126. So that we're consistent with how we're doing voting on issues that are pull requests. Pat, 122, document offboarding retirement process for CentOS SIGs.
I think we're in good shape for that. The last open question was, do we have any special requirements for our secure boot stuff?
Brian, do we have any special requirements?
No, not yet.
Okay.
There may be something that we add to that later on in the process, but we've got to get a group of people together to discuss that first.
Okay. But we're good to do something more broader and what's in ticket number 122, I believe.
Yep.
It's 122. Okay. So let's go ahead and get that done. And even if we do need to add something later, we'll make a new issue for it. And the last one I had pulled as anonymous was public integration testing for stream. And that too is you, Brian.
Yeah, we gave this to the integration SIG, so I would just close this.
Okay. We'll do that right now. Okay, I'll have to log in to do it, so I'll do it when we're done. Okay, so those were the four randomly selected issues I picked, knowing that Sean and Josh were both going to be missing this meeting, so I didn't want to have anything that included either of them because they wouldn't be able to participate. And I was crossing my fingers. I'm happy to see Brian was here because I did select two of his. So I put in for the community architect update. He's traveling. Sean is traveling to scale where we're going to do the workshop, I believe, tomorrow.
It's tomorrow afternoon. Yes.
Are you going to that too, Neil?
Yeah, I'll be there.
Okay. So I know Sean was asking for updates from the different SIGs to add into the slide deck for that. And then it was going to finish out with Carl's packaging workshop. So a little bit of governance, a little bit about the community and the project, and then finishing out with that. That's all I know about scale myself. Do we have anything for the floor? This could be the world's quickest CentOS board meeting.
Is it worth talking about EOL stuff in person, or do you want to just leave that on the mailing list?
The face-to-face?
No, the EOL day messaging on the...
No, that's actually a good thing we can talk about. Because only a couple of us actually responded to the email. Troy, you're not aware of this. But basically, there was some feedback that it's hard to find the end-of-life information on the CentOS website. So Bex had brought that forward to the board. We had a couple suggestions. I think the leading suggestion is more clarity in a footer. Am I correct on that?
Well, that's what I was, I think I was the last person to reply there. And I was just trying to get some sort of summary because I wasn't sure. That's all a bunch of replies that we were in agreement, but I wasn't sure what we were actually on.
Well, we were trying to get everyone to give their comments and not just be two people when at that point when Bex came back to the group. If everyone's in favor of improving the footer versus doing a header or something else, we can move forward with that.
I think I added on another suggestion. In my comment, and I think at the risk of making it more complex than it needs to be, was to have a page, like an EOL page with all the information clear and organized in a way that it wouldn't be on the front page, not sort of like an odd sort of counterpart to the RHEL life cycle page that Red Hat maintains. And that's something we could link in a footer or any sort of place we want to link it on the main page. But and I think I also suggested that it might be good to have it be in one of the menu dropdowns as well. I was just trying to think. My concern about the footer is that when I load the page, at least, I have to scroll down three whole page links to get to the footer. And I think that's even less visible than what we have now.
Okay. Bex?
I agree with you that there's concerns around the footer because of the amount of time you have to scroll down. I like the idea of a page that's clear with detailed information. I'm proxying this concern, to be very candid about it. RHEL PMM has been trying to figure out why people can't figure out that this is going to happen. And so they've been looking at all of the ways that people acquire information. And they came to me and they said, hey, like this really is not visible from the page in a useful way. We're worried that people who even try to come here for this information aren't going to get to it. And so that's where we came to, it doesn't seem to be there. And there is that box in the middle, if you go look at the page right now, that links to something, but like you've got to go, as I recall, it's like vaguely worded and then you have to go read a whole blog post. And that was why they were recommending a higher up the page, more visible statement on end of life. It is no other purpose other than like, we're literally trying to figure out why people aren't getting this information.
Neil, go ahead.
I think the reason why people aren't getting the information is because it is just never been prominent, like ever, whenever we've on the website or the or any of the materials, when you're looking at it from documentation perspective. We don't even have it on the landing page, a reference or a link to the life cycles of CentOS itself. Historically, CentOS has tried very hard to be vague about this. I have personally always disagreed with this vagueness. And that practice has kind of influenced how the current website design exists too. For all intents and purposes, linking to RHEL documentation on the CentOS website is completely pointless, because it is a whole lot of extra detail and nuttiness that isn't really necessary to convey the point that a CentOS stream release is supported for 5.5 years. It is just that simple. And we should just make it that simple. Just say CentOS stream releases are supported for 5.5 years from the date of release.
Bex?
No problem with simple statements. I want to draw us back to the fact that this is primarily a CentOS Linux 7 motivated conversation, just so that we solve the immediate problem of people who literally do not realize they are running out of road, regardless of how they choose to solve the problem of running out of road. But I agree that simple statements about the life cycle of CentOS Stream are great. And that as we move forward, we should try to make those.
Okay, I brought up the page. Are people not, I mean, because I was thinking, oh, we could just put it on where it says contribute forums, mailing list, IRC. And I like the idea, Mike, that you had of linking to a full page. But then I scrolled down just a teeny bit more and we have a big yellow box. Or is that not visible enough for basic information? Then we could add that new page with more detailed information. And as Neil said, simple statements of our end of life cycle. You know, we can even do kind of a roadmap type flow. Bex?
We could potentially just rewrite that text to include the dates, and then link it to either the existing blog post with a for details, see this, or to a new page. But the challenge that I think PMM has identified with this text is it doesn't create a sense of urgency. It doesn't really convey a lot of information. And then you have to go and do more work. They're trying to approach it from the perspective of someone who's not soaking in this every day like we all are.
Right.
No, it's also there's also a subtlety here. The lifecycle dates are below the fold when you load the website up. You do not see it right when the page loads. At least on my browser on a laptop with a 1080p panel, I have to scroll before I see the end of life stuff. So any
I'm scrolling, I'll say this much.
Yeah, it's still scrolling though.
Yeah.
My perspective is anything that's important must be above the fold and not below the fold. If it's below the fold, no one is going to see it.
So a suggestion is, and I don't know if we can do it, I might have to talk to Alon, is if we could move it above the contribute forums, mailing lists, et cetera, and improve the wording. Pat?
My inkling would be on the download pages to actually basically reverse the order of them.
Or yeah, right, put it now right below the version. Put it right below the version.
Yeah, I would be tempted to do end of life, documentation, download links.
Yeah, that would fix the problem. And no one cares if download links are below the fold. You're going to scroll for those anyway.
Yeah.
So we're saying on the download page, move end of life up underneath the version.
Yep. Basically take that three my brain says hamburger, but that three black lines, and I would basically flip them 100% upside down.
Okay.
So that it's end of life, then documentation that nobody ever reads, but if it's the second link on the page, we can at least say, come on! And then have the links to architectures, packages, and other.
Okay, and how do we feel about the very fact that on the very top of that page is, again, that yellow block, which we've all admitted that we need to improve the wording for that?
Take the yellow block away, make the EOL dates yellow.
Well, yeah, put the dates actually in the yellow block.
Well, no, I'm saying that they...
whatever the block is, somewhere right there.
We already have an end of life section that's below the fold. When we move it up to the top, right below the version, we always make, we just make that another color. We make it prominent and you will not miss it.
Okay.
And if you miss it, I don't know how to help you anymore. But like it'll be like, we don't need a yellow block up the top that conditionally exists and a block below it that's always there. Let's just make the block that has the end of life date always prominent. And as it gets closer to the end, we make it more and more warning.
Okay. No, I like this. Whether we can do it or not is another story.
And if we have the big page that we can link to for the detailed information, then that can be linked multiple places. And I kind of like the idea that I put forth about having it also under the about dropdown or similar. That way it might not be visible at the very top, but it's there at the very top. And also, now that I'm looking at these again, and it's kind of an aesthetic thing, but the pale, yet the kind of middle purple lavender on the pale yellow, I find my eyes are averse to when it clashes with everything else on the page. And I kind of wonder if people don't see it because they don't.
I mean, that's why my eyes go right off of it. It's like, I don't want to read this because it looks like something horrifically unattractive to look at.
All right, hang on, I'm writing notes and I want to run them past everybody as soon as I'm done writing the notes. We wanted to reverse the whole order. Okay, so we want to move the yellow block up above the fold on the main page. Do we still want to do that?
Drop the yellow block.
That's on the main page?
Oh, there's a yellow block on the main page?
Uh-huh.
There is no
yellow. Where? I don't see it.
Underneath the fold.
Oh, wow, that's the worst. Yeah, it needs to be up at the top.
Okay.
See, I was just talking about the yellow block that was on the download page.
And look at more accessible colors.
Yeah.
Okay. And then on the download page, we're going to remove the yellow block and reverse the whole order of sections to be end of life, docs, and download. And if needed, open it to an issue with a loan. What's the name of that SIG? Graphic SIG?
It's the artwork SIG.
Artwork SIG, thank you. Okay. Because the loan should definitely be able to help us find better colors. All right, Mike, I'm really glad you brought this up.
Yeah, definitely. And I do like that idea of having a page that just has our high priority dates on it.
Yeah. What do we want to call that? Add page of upcoming dates.
I like lifetime dates.
Lifetime?
Life cycle, something like that.
Yeah, I just call them high priority dates. And then
Just don't use the word support.
I would never use that word. Thank you. Priority dates. Okay. Oh, hang on. I guess I should tab all these in. All righty.
I'll only add that I do think it is important, and I understand Neil's concern to keep the links into the rel dates, only because since we do judge so much from those, we want people to be able to see what the source is if that source changes. I'm not suggesting that it has to be the most prominent thing that is on that page, but I think it's important to keep those links.
The issue I have with the documentation, it is unless you're a business person, that document is extremely confusing. And that is the problem I have with it.
I am strongly encouraging us to write a document that is consumable by the audience that we wish to address with this information. I'm simply saying that I think this should still be a link that is available in
that's
that
fine, as documentation. Long as it's not
the primary one. I'm not suggesting that it has to be that we cut and paste language from it, nor am I suggesting that it has to be the first thing that we tell someone to read. But we should be clear that we are drawing information and inspiration from that.
Yeah, as long as it's not the first link and not the primary source that we're relying on from conveying information to people, I don't care. That's fine.
Yeah, just some sort of citation.
Exactly.
And I'll throw this out there. What if, because we've talked about repos going away. If we can maintain slightly longer because things are passing CI, can we? Is there anything saying that we can't go 6 years if we want to go 6 years and everything's passing CI still?
Well, the code's not really going to be committed into the repo. So I'm not sure would have to maintain.
Okay.
I mean, in theory, Git repos could be forked into our namespace to do it, but I have a feeling that Daddy Shadow Man would get very unhappy about it.
I would want to understand the strategy of what is being proposed before we just make a blanket statement that we're going to do that. I also think that it's important for us to follow up with Brian and make sure that we understand what's going to be happening in terms of builds and composes, because there may not be anything to pass to CI without a plan for something further, and I'd like to look at that plan.
No, it was just a curiosity, because if the way I understand it now, and I could be wrong, is that the repos that we utilize will eventually go away, and that's why we have an end of date. But if they didn't need anything added to them after a certain period of time, could we have a longer life cycle without any other resources being needed except putting them on the mirrors? That's just my question.
Those are orthogonal concerns. The fact that we delete repos has nothing to do with life cycle. The fact that we delete repos is because of a legacy CentOS decision that we could just not keep doing. Like, that is, I personally have always disagreed with deleting repos, because that's, it's painful and breaky and bad and in all kinds of ugly ways. But it doesn't change anything about life cycle stuff, right? Whether it's 5 years or 10 years.
All right, Troy, then Pat.
I just wanted to clarify what you're saying. Are you saying something beyond just keeping up on the mirrors? Are you saying we rebuild packages and actively keep CentOS stream? Because I'm not understanding what you're asking.
So my understanding when we pick the end of life in the communication is there's something that we get and we determine our end of life based on when that is going away. So,
correct.
Okay. So I'm just asking the question because Bex has often challenged us to do something amazing. So I'm trying to think of something. is if we could have a longer life cycle, like with RDOs, there's some projects that have been marked as inactive. And we have made the decision to make it easier on folks using RDO to, as long as those inactive projects are still passing our CI, leave them in a little longer for people to move off of them. So in the same nature of that, could we keep going a little longer than the 5.5 years or so if it helps people out?
Without any updates, either security or feature-wise, just...
Because if they're not being contributed for security and feature-wise, unless somebody wants to make a contribution, there wouldn't be additional work done on them.
Okay, I will... Now I understand what you're saying. I will be quiet and let others talk.
Pat?
My concern with that is people don't move unless you make them. Without naming and shaming, I am aware of some Scientific Linux 3 boxes that are in the wild. And
kill me.
Oh my God, you made me choke saying that.
And that tells me several things about human behavior. And one of them is maybe these people are still running Yum Update to check them. And they're exploding because we've moved the repos off. If we don't move the repos off, they won't explode.
Okay.
And that may provide a false sense of there are still updates.
Bex?
So I would encourage any ideas along these lines to have a strong plan and then to be validated against what's going to happen. My understanding, and I'm very open to being corrected here, is that we'd have no intentions of seeing contribution pathways, and there's no intentions of seeing builds out of those code repositories. So we're back into what Troy was alluding to, which is we've basically left you a security challenge. And I don't think that that's a great move for the project to innovate around creating ways for you to have a security hunt in your infrastructure. I also, without having seen any firm plan or idea, did not intend coasting to be the thing that the board should feel like is its challenging opportunity to embrace. I think that we have other cool things we could go do that don't rely on that. And I kind of come back to that central question that seems to come up in these conversations, which is, are we looking for an OS to lean on? And if so, what are we wanting to define that as? Are we looking to be a platform for certain kinds of innovation or creation? And what does that rely on? And I think without answers to those questions, it becomes easy to say, hey, you know, let's just go see if we can make 6 months more on this, when we don't really know why that may not even be helpful to people, is right. Kind of what I'm getting at. Without a plan and an understanding of the audience that you're going to. I understand and I appreciate the idea and the thinking. It's just really hard for me to be positive on it without regard to the fact that I now talk as Red Hat. Like, Red Hat isn't positive on this because it doesn't make sense. And I can feel like this is going to explode when somebody finds that security problem in their infrastructure in a very negative way for both the project and the company. I mean, I don't want to see that.
No, and I do like the idea, if it was even possible, as Troy mentioned, to take in security and feature upgrades. But there was no plan. This was like totally off the cuff based on the conversation we were having about end of life and life cycles and if there was anything we could do to help our users. But yes, I understand that there's people who are never going to move unless we take things and close them out, and they'll keep running the old thing that once someone finds out they're running it, they can just rootkit them within 5 seconds. So this was definitely a fact-finding, is this even possible question. And without opening up for contributions, I don't think it is a worthwhile endeavor. All right.
I think, the more important endeavor to keep in mind here is addressing the psychology of why people are stuck on older releases. While we talk about their, like, I know Shadow Man's concern is usually with the super large companies and whatever, and having these weird platforms. And this is similar to the weird science labs that don't know how to deal with computers and have software that feels way too sticky to be able to change anything. But the Gen Pop CentOS audience, the biggest problem is that upgrading is too hard. And maybe that is the part of the focus that we need to start actually thinking about and prioritizing within the CentOS stream platform, is making it so moving from major release to major release is as easy as it is in Fedora. There's no technical reason why it shouldn't be possible. It is merely the lack of prioritization focus and frankly care that has historically existed for in-place upgrades. I think that is a more useful endeavor than trying to figure out a coasting strategy.
Which makes me ask the question, is an upgrade SIG possible? Lance, you had your hand up though.
Yeah, I just had a realization while I was actually working on something here. How does the CentOS 8 stream end of life affect the SIG? So for example, I'm consuming RDO using ARM Linux 8, but I'm using CentOS stream 8 streams for some of the dependencies. Are those going to go away at the end of life?
They don't have to.
Yeah, I was going to say, they don't have to. It's kind of the similar thing that Amy was mentioning with the RDOs, that is, if they're still there. But that was a concern I just had, because those of us that are still running, you know, another like Alma or Rocky or whatever, we're still consuming. Those still work, but the repo shouldn't go away for that. But I don't know. I just thought of that. I didn't even think of that before.
Well, each SIG can also opt into providing EL8 repos and tag packages into there. I would encourage such SIGs who have content that are deliberately compatible with standard EL8 and EL9 platforms, even if they're building for Stream 8 and 9, to consider tagging them for publish into a dedicated EL8 or EL9 repo, so that they can be consumed independently, because those will not get mirror disabled when Stream 8 and Stream 9 EOL.
Right. Okay.
We at a certain level, we want Stream 8 users to feel a little bit of, where did my packages go a week after end of life?
Yes, but I'm not a Stream 8 user. I'm a consumer of some of those packages, but not the main OS.
I also don't know if that's a universally held opinion, Pat.
Oh, dear.
I mean, I know that, again, not on the board, but I contribute to a lot of CentOS. I think it's a bad idea to rip the repos out. And it's unnecessarily painful. But the reason that we do it is because, again, the other underlying reasons why people don't upgrade are never addressed. And we need to start doing that.
So it sounds like we need some surveys to try to find out why people aren't upgrading. The trouble is finding the audience to actually fill out the surveys, because we don't keep track of who is downloading. So that is definitely something we can work on, is try to get more information. Because without that information, we can make decisions and it won't impact anybody because they don't care. So
if we could have some clarity on the life cycle for the SIG content, that would be nice too.
Okay. I think that's whatever the SIG wants to do. That's the clarity. So ask the SIG and they can give you their own statements.
And so where do they publish?
On their website. They can publish it on their website? Each SIG has their own website.
Okay.
For example, Hyperscale, we are aggressively tied to the stream life cycles. And while we haven't made a final decision, both David and I are leaning towards, we are going to disable the tags, but probably leave the content alone for Stream 8 when we end of life the Stream 8 content. But not every SIG will make that choice. You'll have to ask them.
It's a lot of good discussion.
All right, is there any other discussion? All right, I'm going to call the meeting at an end.